Hey, everybody. Welcome back to First Frequency of Oneness, Shock Metaphysics. I am your host, Rev Shock, the metaphysical Morpheus, a.k.a. Shocktopus Prime, a.k.a. Shook Shock, a.k.a. Shook Shocker, a.k.a. metaphysical gangster, a.k.a. why does he do this every damn time? Shut up and get the show started. We're back with Dr. Clyde Winters, and he is coming again with some heat tonight. Fam, and he's going to be presenting the first foundational Black Americans, the Paleoamericans. This is one for the books. Welcome back, my good elder. How have you been? How's your week been?
It's been just fine. I'm getting along okay.
Wonderful, wonderful. You're looking good. You're looking good, and I'm looking forward to this lecture, and I've got some questions, of course, for you on this topic. I want to send a shout out to Michael Scott. I see you were up there saying he can't wait. Derek Fuller, welcome back. Tiana Bean from Bermuda, what's going on, Queen Mother? I love you so much. She is so supportive and has been following our stuff for years. George Montgomery, I see you, brother, B1. This is a topic that, again, levels the playing field. Some people are going to love what they hear, and then there's going to be some that are not going to really like this at all. So that being said, how did you become interested in the history of Black Indians, particularly?
Well, I became interested in it because of my mother and my wife, kind of.
Sure. Let's get your PowerPoint. I forgot you had PowerPoints. We should have got that set up in the green room. We were in there talking about all kind of good stuff that we're going to be bringing to y'all, some conversations that need to be had, and also some history and information that needs to be corrected. All right, here we go. Okay, we're going to put that up, port it in, and then we're going to go full screen, good doctor, so the family can see everything. Family, are you able to see that in full screen? So if so, just hit a yes in the chat. Brian Bino, I see you out there, brother, from another mother. George Montgomery, Emil O, Melissa Johnson, Jerome Walker, welcome, welcome, welcome. The family's coming in. Go ahead, good doctor. Talk to us about this.
Okay, well, what happened is that my mother, she told me, she was telling me back in the day that we were Choctaw. Mm-hmm. So, of course, when she said we were Choctaw, I said, well, okay, so what? And the reason I said so what was because of the fact that back in the 50s and 60s, it was a lot of Western shows, a lot of cowboy shows. And when you looked at the Westerns, you know, the Indians always got killed. The Indians mm-hmm. always lost. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so naturally, I felt that, being a Choctaw, that was nice. But, I think I should look at my African heritage a little bit more because we had ancient Malay. So I didn't really think about it too much until I got to be a senior.
Okay.
When I got to be a senior in high school, you know, I decided I was going to do a survey. And in this survey, I asked the other senior students, how many of them had Indian ancestry? And I was surprised that it was about 60 to 70%, said that they had Indian ancestry. And so, you know, I said, wow, that's cool. And, but I really didn't do a lot of research into it. Okay. As you can see, here we have some of the full-blooded Choctaw, and you can see the current chief. The current chief of the Choctaw in Oklahoma is a white guy. Yes.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
White guy. That's crazy. He's one of those $5 Indians.
But as you can see, I was going to say, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, not only that, but what they did in Oklahoma is that anytime a black person or a black Indian or a Mongoloid Indian, anytime they found oil on their land, they had to have a white supervisor. They had to have a white supervisor help them manage the oil fields. And usually what the white supervisor did is that usually he would either marry them or have the Indian marry their sister, and then the Indian or the black person would die. And then they would take over the wealth. That's one of the reasons why, that's how the FBI was kind of began in a way to go investigate what was going on down in Oklahoma. But still, they didn't try to stop it because they just felt it was okay. But again, as you can see, when my mom said that we were Choctaw, you know, I mean, hey, she was right. But I didn't really get involved in it. Then when I got married, my wife, she was, you know, she was very
beautiful, beautiful.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. You know, I miss her a great deal. But I mean, hey, the mother goddess, you better hold him while you got him. But yes, she had a very interesting background. On her mother's side, her mother, she didn't know what Indian tribe she belonged to because all she remembered was that her grandmother couldn't speak English. You know, her grandmother only spoke Indian. And she remembered that her grandmother was mean. And so she and but on her father's side, her father they came from Georgia. Her mother came from Arkansas. My parents came from Mississippi. But on her father's side, he came from Georgia. He was a part Cherokee. And his dad was Cherokee and his mother was Blackfeet.
Mm-hmm.
So as you can see, the Cherokees, you know, most of them were black. What they did in the old days, and one day I may do a discussion of our Indian heritage, but I'm not going to do that today. But the interesting thing about that is that, as you can see, what they did is that to take the land away from black Indians, they would always say you were colored, or they would say you were a free black, and in this way they could take away your land. For example, in Rhode Island, among this one Indian tribe, they had a four mile reservation, and the white man eventually kept taking the land, and today they only have 3 acres. Only have 3 acres because you know, white people never tried to have treaties with black Indians. What they did is just took our land and did whatever they wanted to. Under this girl, you can see Sequoia. Sequoia is very interesting. We don't know if that's how he looked. This is a made-up painting of a Sequoia. But if you notice, he wore a turban, and he's quote-unquote invented a writing system. But it wasn't really a writing system that he invented. He was just using the by-writing system. And as you can tell, he was deeply influenced, you know, by Muslims. And it's very important to remember is that, sure, when the Moors say that we were here, before the white man, they're not lying, but you still don't want to take a Moor identity. Then on the left side, on the bottom, we see a Blackfoot. This is a Blackfoot child, and then we see in the center a Blackfoot Indian.
Mm-hmm.
It's very important to understand that whites have never really wanted to respect us for our Indian heritage and the fact that we're both African and Indian, you see. But what I'm going to talk about today is I'm going to try to explain to you why they're so afraid. Wow. And one of the reasons that they're so afraid of us, is because the fact is that they know the real history.
See,
just because they don't tell you your history, they know our history. And they know who we are and what we are. They know that we're first frequency. And because they know that we're first frequency, that makes them afraid.
Ashe. So then the question is, who are they, who are or who were the first foundational Black Americans? Who were the first FBAs, if you will?
Okay, let me share the screen again.
Okay. Okay, there we go. Everybody
okay,
see that?
Yeah, first okay. Foundational Black Americans were called Paleoamericans. Okay. And they call them Paleoamericans because what they found is that that when they found these skeletons, and when they began to examine these skeletons, what they discovered is that these skeletons were not of Mongoloid Indians.
Mm.
The people who they put on TV today, the Apache and people like that, they were not the original Indians. They found that these black people, and the reason they called them black people is because the fact is that they did what's called, you know, reconstruction of the faces when they found the skeletons. And when they reconstructed these faces were of black people, just like you and me, you see.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so this was very dangerous because what it proved is that black people had been over here for 100,000 years, you see.
Wow.
Quadrophages, he was a current researcher. What he did is that he had reported numerous Negro tribes. As you can see, here we have some Paleoamericans and Mongoloid Indian. On the right, we have, on the left, we have Naya. She's from Mexico. We have Lucia, which is from a woman who was found in Brazil. These skeletal remains that they used to reconstruct these faces are over 13,000 to 15,000 years old.
My God.
We've been here. We've been here. But what they always tell you is, you better go back to Africa. No, you better go back to Europe because we belong here. We are the Paleo-Americans. But as you can see, we look nothing like Indians. What they use to really determine Paleo-Americans is what's called craniometrics. And craniometrics, what they do is that they study your face, they get a skull. When they study the facial features, they can tell if you were an Asian or Mongoloid person, a European person, or if you were an African or a Negro person. And the way that they can do this is they have certain measurements. One of the things about the cranium that can show the difference between the races is around the nose.
Mm.
There's features around the nose that will in a sense show that you belong to either an Asian population, a Negro or African population, or a Mongoloid population. And what they found is that all of the Paleo-Americans, they always say that phenotypically. In other words, they have the same traits as Africans, Australians, or Melanesians.
Mm-hmm.
You see,
mm-hmm.
They never just say African because the fact is that they don't want you to believe that Africans did anything except come over here and work for them.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But if they tell you that the first people over here were Africans, then you might think, hey, you know, first frequency is kind of cool. Hey, first frequency has been around here a long time, you see.
Real talk.
You know? And so what they found in a sense is that there was a puzzle. And this puzzle is, where did these Mongoloid people come from? Because they don't find any skeletons.
Now, didn't you say earlier, Dr. Winters, in previous appearances, wasn't there three different types of migrations that occurred? After the first frequency people were already here. And then there was a mating kind of thing, you know, and some of the admixture got more mixed up. Can you refresh our memory on that, beloved?
Okay, what happened is that the first, and that's what we're going to talk about in this particular series, the first people came over here about 130,000 years ago.
Okay.
130,000 years ago, there was no way to walk into America because of the Ice Age. Because there was ice all the way into Asia, and the northern part of the North American continent, you know, parts of America all the way through Canada, up into parts of Alaska was under ice. Although this area was under ice, black people were sailing over here from Africa beginning around 130,000 years ago.
Wow.
And then when they came over here from Africa, they began to settle and they began to have these ancient sites. But what happened is that after 12,000 BC, through a period of deglaciation, much of the ice began to melt. And then as the ice melted in Alaska, as it melted in North America, then you find, in a sense, other Black people coming here that walked from Asia. And okay, we find, in a sense, that the first people to arrive in the Americas who were Black that came from Africa were the people we call Australians. Next, we find around 44,000 to 22,000 BC, we find that the Khoisan people in South Africa, today they talk about the Khoisan having the Asian fold and other things, they sailed to America. But after 12,000 BC, we see the Ainu begin to migrate from Asia into the Americas. And after them came the modern Africans like us, who are taller. And we began to come into America after the Ainu by land and sea. But they'll tell you that the Paleoamericans, they were, in a sense, a Negro people. You know, and the most important thing you had to remember about this is that they did this and they knew this. You know, the white men always knew this. You know, this guy named Howell, what he did is that he began to develop the measurements that we use to determine what racial characteristics a cranium might have or a skull might have. You know, he had found right away that Black people had been here, because he originally, when they first talked about people coming from Asia, they weren't talking about Mongoloid people.
Mm-hmm.
They were talking about the Australians, or maybe Melanesians may have walked from Asia into the United States. And they had already known, even as early as the 1900s, that, you know, as Black people found in Brazil, Colombia, Florida, southern Patagonia, throughout there. But what happened is that the Americans began to say, hey, we can't let it be known that some Black people were here in America first. And they didn't want you to know that Black people were in America first, because that meant that we, yes, owned the land, which was proven by the fact that when the Portuguese and Spanish came to America, they called the first inhabitants Indians.
Mm-hmm.
And they called the first inhabitants of North America and the Caribbean Indians, because they were Black.
Fantastic.
Just like the people who lived in South India.
Fantastic.
See, you know, the Portuguese and the Spanish, they didn't trade with North India where there were light-skinned people. They traded in South India among the Tamil, the Pandya, the Tola,
amongst their own people.
Yeah, and so these were all Black people. And these Black people that came from Africa. And so what they did is that after they found these skeletons, they began to reconstruct the faces of Naiya. Apiuna, they believe that he lived among the in the same place, Lagoa Santor, down in Brazil, where Luzia lived. When you look at this Luzia skull, Luzia is very interesting. Because last year they burned down the museum where Luzia's bones were.
Are you serious right now?
Yes, they burned it down. And then shortly after they burned it down, then they came out and said that Luzia was really white.
Wow.
They made a whole new reconstruction. But see, that's what history is. See, ancient history is, I'm white and I say so. In other words, whenever they find anything disturbing about ancient history, they always try to say that this or that is so. That's one of the reasons why ancient aliens has become so famous. Because they're talking about things that First Frequency did that they don't understand how we did it. So rather than say that Black people did it, say that First Frequency, like you, Reverend Matthews, and like the audience, instead of saying that it was done by First Frequency, they'd rather say it was aliens from outer space.
That's right. That's right. You're absolutely right, Doc.
It's scary.
That's how, that's how sick they are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
See, how can they tell you that you were the first people in America, not just the first people on earth, that you were the first people in America?
That's right.
That means that you know this place. And then if you were the first people in America, how can they say you can't learn in these damn schools? How can they say that your kids should be put in special education? How can they say that your kids are dumb when they learned everything from you?
I got something that I've got something that might be a tad bit disturbing. I want to put this up on the screen for you, Doc.
Okay.
Somebody named Angel says salute, but with all due respect, Dr. Winters is vested in the out of Africa theory now being revisited by archaeogeneticists. Aborigines are Mars or Moors all over Earth. M-A-U-R. Yeah. What's that about?
Okay. What happened is that some people, they want to say everybody's a Moor because the Moors. You know, but the Moors didn't appear until Islam. It was black people already in out of Africa before Moors. Moors wear turbans. You know why Moors wear turbans? They wear turbans because turbans in Islam is a sign of your education. A lot of people over here wear a turban because they just think it's fashion. No, it shows that you were a teacher or a professor. But the whole point is that the out of Africa theory is the only theory that we can have. And I'm going to explain to you why. A lot of indigenous people who live on reservations, like the Narragansett and a few other black Indians, who were able to keep their reservation credentials. Mm-hmm. They want to believe, in a sense, that they're a unique people. No, you're not a unique people. I'm sorry to say, you're not a unique people.
Mm.
See, you're Great. Not a unique people, and I'll explain to you why. We don't have any evidence. We don't have any evidence of people in America. Maybe the Ice Age destroyed it, but we don't have any evidence of people in America before Africans came here 130 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
The reason mm-hmm. we know that these people came from Africa is that the tools, the scrapers, the arrowheads that they used were first used in Africa. And if they were first used in Africa, they had to have come from Africa, right?
You see? Absolutely.
And so that's how the white man took over Africa. That's how the white man took over North America. You know, you want to know why, Reverend?
Why is that, good elder?
They took over Africa and America because we were always tribalistic. Manchiichi, Seminole, Creek, you know, Algonquin, whatever. We always count ourselves a bunch of different people, and he used that against us to fight each other. And as we fought each other, he took the land away from us. There's only one way. There's only one way for us to return first frequency, and the only way we can return first frequency is get out of this tribalism. Call yourself a Moor, a Hebrew, a Christian. There's nothing wrong with being a Christian. That's your religion. There's nothing wrong with being a Muslim. That's your religion. There's nothing wrong with being a Hebrew. That's your religion. There's nothing wrong with saying that you're Narragansett. That's your ethnic nationality. But to the white man, you're black.
Come on. Yes,
so
sir.
So you have to be B1.
That's right.
B1.
Everybody, B1. Put it in the chat. Put it in the chat. They already started. CC, I see you, goddess.
B1.
I see you. Darlene X, I see you. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Tariq Nasheed, when he said foundational Black Americans, he created a term that includes all of us.
That's right. That's
it
right.
It includes
That's
all right. of us. Instead That's of saying right. I'm this or I'm that or I'm that or this. Look at Africa today. Africa today. They all fighting each other. Why? Because you got Muslims in the north of Nigeria, Christians in the south. Then you got the Igbo. You got the Igbo fighting the Ojibwe. Then you got the people in the river states. They feel as a over and over again. When will we learn?
Yes, sir. Come on. Bring that eldership.
B1. B1. But black anatomical modern day. Humans came to America 100,000 years ago. And we know.
Well, I guess that question was answered. thank you, Angel. Hopefully you got something.
The reason we know this is we look at the skulls. The skulls tell you they were black people. Yes, you're right. You're right, sister. It was black people on every continent.
Excellent.
But they came from Africa first because Africa is the most stable continent. Yeah, it was a little ice in Africa on the Atlas Mountains, but for the most part, Africans never had to suffer that stuff.
I like what Deneen says. Deneen is new to the show. She says we seeded the whole planet, and that is accurate. That is that's a great way to say it. We seeded the entire planet.
That's right.
That is correct.
But
yes,
when the white man tried to tell you that all races came from Africa, that's a lie. As we discussed in the talk on the races, they originated outside Africa, in Central Asia. It's never been any white people or Asians in Africa. So when they teach you that, that's a lie.
Hold on. For some reason, this is Sabrina D is asking how did we seed the entire planet coming from the continent of Africa? And I appreciate the questions, and I want to get this cleared up before we go back to your PowerPoint. But I want to have this conversation with you, Elder, because as I see it, there's a thing called the desirability bias, and it's part of the 175 critical thinking eras. And the desirability bias is when we think that everybody thinks the way we think and sees the world the way we see the world. Well, we know that's not the case. So that's why we're doing what we're doing right now. From my understanding, and you're going to correct me if I'm incorrect, there was one point when all the continents were connected, but of course everything came and was gestated in Africa. But then as that population, as us, we began to grow and expand as a populace, we began to travel. We began to move out into various different places, and then that would seed all of the other continents because we were here first. And even if maybe, I don't know, and you're going to tell us, even if there were continents that weren't connected, we built ships, we started moving about, and started relocating to other parts of the world. Is that the answer for Sabrina on how we seeded the entire
world? Okay, Gondwanaland, when the various continents were united, that was 5 million years ago. Human beings Homo sapiens do not occur until about 300 years ago. So it couldn't have been like that. Also, you got to remember that whenever there's a tectonic change, and whenever the continents split, there's the various continents are on various shales, and they move and plates, around.
Those plates.
And so what happens
is that
whenever they move dramatically, there's a lot of earthquakes and all that type of stuff. Remember during that period, the dinosaurs and all that were killed off. But what happened is that in Africa, we talked about this in earlier lectures. They had what was called Mega Chad. They had Mega Congo. And Mega Chad was over 100,000 miles wide. A lake. It's only 2,000 miles from Africa to Brazil. Think about that.
Wow.
In Africa, Mega Chad was 200,000, over 100,000 miles wide. And so then the black people in Africa, that's why we find so many rock inscriptions or rock depictions of boats in the Sahara. We find all these depictions of boats because that's how people got around. They got around on boats.
There you go. And now, let me add this too. Sabrina is coming with, she says, how do we know? ? I thought we were all from one landmass, Lemuria. Lemuria, and that became America, Asia, Africa.
No, Lemuria is a different, is a whole different place. Lemuria is what you would call, Lemuria is what's called Kumari Nadu. The white man made up a lot of bullshit. He talked about Mu. He talked about Mu and he say Mu is Lemuria. And Lemuria, no. Lemuria is based upon what the Dravidians talked about, Kumari Nadu. Kumari Nadu was a land that connected East Africa, India, and Australia. And so people could at one time walk all the way from East Africa all the way to India or Australia. Wow. The white man teach you that this landmass disappeared millions of years ago. But the Dravidians in India said it didn't disappear, you know, millions of years ago. It disappeared only a few thousand years ago. In fact, the Pandians go back there. And so, as I said, is that you have to do your own research. When they talk about Mu, Lemuria, that's made up shit. I'm sorry. That's made up stuff.
Don't apologize. That's why you're our elder.
But Kumari Nadu is a little bit different. And so
now let's get back to our PowerPoint here, Paleo-American. Hopefully that answered the questions for you goddesses out there.
And if they come up with any more questions, it's fine. But again, I'm going to tell you guys is that.
Okay, hold on. This is probably as close to a debate as you're going to see on my show. Angel. Says salute. The geologic record dates North America, the oldest landmass. This fact cannot be disputed.
No,
it is not a theory. This is what she's. I don't know.
No,
this is
what no.
So let's get it. Let's get it on and pop. That's why we here.
I'm not gonna even entertain that.
Okay. All right.
That's silly. That's silly. How could it be the oldest landmass? Remember. If Gondwana land was the original mega continent, right? It included Africa, South America, North America, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if Gondwana land existed and it included North America, South America, and Africa, which one is the oldest? they're all the same. think, young lady. I'm not trying to put anybody down, but you had to think.
Yeah.
Think. If you think, you see, yes, I'm going off what the white man said, but the white man supported it with archaeology. You can't say North America is the oldest continent when North America, South America, Africa, and all of them were at one time connected.
Exactly. There it is.
And if they were connected, how could one continent be older than the other one? See,
this is why we love you.
And so, and that's why if you go back in time, that was millions of years ago. The dinosaurs ruled Earth at one time. Remember?
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to go up and in. But see, the white man, I'm just going off what we can discuss in terms of skeletal remains and archaeological sites.
Okay, I'm going to put this slide back up here.
On this slide, what's that?
I'm putting the slide back up. Go ahead, Doc.
Okay. On this slide, you can see the Paleo-Americans. We have Kennewick man, we have Panao woman, we have Naia, and we have, Lazia. And these skeletons are all dated to around 10,000 years ago. In the map on the other side, you can see where some of the various skeletons were found. Like we can see on your knee cave up in Alaska, dates to 10,000, Kennewick man, Anzac trout, pelican, all of these different sites on this map is where they found Paleo-Americans. And again, these Paleo-Americans, because of the structure of their skulls, these were African people. The Paleo-American sites, they date between 6,000 and 100,000 years ago. And so again, we can see some of these Paleo-Americans. We find in a sense that the first migration to America probably was with the Australians in 130 BC. But we found in a sense that, and this is very interesting, the white men always want to tell you about the Clovis culture. And the reason he tells you about the Clovis culture is because he wants to, in a sense, say that America was only occupied after the end of the ice age. See, because he knows if the Clovis culture, which occurred around 12,000 years ago, if there were cultures in America before 12,000 years ago, that means that those cultures had to come from only one place on the planet Earth, Africa. They couldn't have came from Europe because the Beringa or the Bering Straits, whether you cross from Asia into Alaska, that was under ice. It was under ice for thousands of years up to 12,000 BC. But although that era was under ice, we find these black people in America. Some of the sites that they found sites from Canada to Chile that date between 20,000 to 65,000 years old. For example, Oak Crow Basin in Canada is 38,000 years old. Aran Grande Cave is 36,000 years old. At Pedra Furada down in Brazil, 45,000 years old. And at Bluefish Cave, Yukon, Alaska, 24,000 years old.
Wow.
See? But those people who are in Alaska that date to 24,000 years old, they couldn't have walked into North America because it was blocked by ice. And so the only way you can get there is that. The most interesting people is this whole idea about people in America, in California 130,000 years ago. A guy named Richard Cerruti, he found a mastodon bone. And this mastodon bone, and here's a picture of the mastodon bone. The interesting thing about this bone is that they used tools. We would call them scrapers and hammers, but they used tools to trim the meat off of these bones. And by trimming the meat off on these bones, that shows in a sense that it had to have been humans to use those tools. They haven't found any skeletons so far that I've heard of that are 130,000 years old, but they say that people had to have used those bones. And here's a picture of some of the people that used to live in Florida. You see, wow. And as you can tell, most of them a lot of them look Melanesian, but we don't know how they looked 130,000 years ago because I believe they were Australians. Okay. There were two glaciation periods. One glaciation period, and when I say deglaciation, that means when the ice
started to melt.
Right. And so one period is 140,000 to 120,000 years ago, and the second period is 14,000 to 0.7 years ago to 12.8 years ago. And they always try to teach you whenever you go to class that that these people came during that second deglaciation period. And these people were supposed to have brought Clovis tools. But what they found is this. They found that many sites dating to 24,000 years ago, Solutrean tools. The Solutreans were people who, in a sense, lived in Europe. But not only did they live in Europe, they really originated down in South Africa. You see? And wow. So on this map, we can see how the Solutrean tools, they came up from South Africa, and then they went into Iberia, or what we call Spain today, and then from Africa, they came to North America. They had to have come from Africa because, again, you can see, that they couldn't have came from Europe because it was covered with ice. How could the people have stayed warm? And back then they believed people were coasting around the continents. And if people were coasting around the continents, when they got up around North America, they would have froze to death. Ice would have been too thick. Mm-hmm. So the only place these people could have come from was Africa. And we know from the tools. Many people have found in a sense that the interesting thing is that the early Americans, you know, the Paleoamericans, when they did our genetic studies, we're going to talk about that later. When they did the genetic studies, they found that these early Americans they were basically they had the same genetic profile as the Cro-Magnon people in Europe at that time. Many people, they try to tell you that the Cro-Magnon people were the original white people. Not white people got up here until 1500 BC in situation. Mm. Cro-Magnon man is 44,000 years old. And Bali and Valos and Fossil Man, they noted that these ancient tools used by these Europeans were Solutrean tools. Here we can see a Grimaldi statue. And right next to the Grimaldi statue, we see a Khoisan. Do they look alike to you?
Mm-hmm.
They mm-hmm. do to me too.
Absolutely.
Wow. And that's because of the fact that the Khoisan was there. We also find other artifacts from what they call the reindeer age. And here we can find artifacts that also relate to these Khoisan, because the Khoisan, as I said before, when you look at Mega Chad and you look at Mega Congo, and then in South Africa, they had the Bukongo Lake. And just think about a lake being over 100,000 miles.
Yeah, that's crazy.
100,000 miles.
Wow.
They just sailed all the way from South Africa, taking their tools. They sailed all the way into North Africa. Then they went to Morocco. And then when they went to Morocco, these Khoisan took some of their tools and some of their weapons and went into Spain. And they introduced the Lutrian tools then. Other ones came over here. The most important reason that we know about the Salutrian culture is that Dennis Stanford and Bruce Bailey and across the Atlantic ice, they talk about the fact that, look, they found Salutrian tools dating between 25,000 and 13,000 years ago. They found them in the Sinmar site, the Meadowcraft Rock Shelter in Pennsylvania, Oyster Cove, the Chesapeake Bay, Cactus Hill in Virginia, and Miles Point sites. All of these tools, excuse me, that relate to the Salutrian culture, they're not found in Siberia. They're only
absolutely
found
amazing.
In Africa.
Absolutely amazing.
And Spain, where the Khoisan took them. These are some of the tools. As you can see, what they do is that, you know, I remember when I was taking archaeology back in the day, you know, a professor would get in there and he'd have a little stone and he'd chip the tools. And so what happens is that these are tools. These are Solutrean tool points. You know, they call them projectile points. That's just an arrowhead. And so when they look at these arrowheads, they see that they're made in a specific way and that when they try to chip them off, they had to be chipped in a certain way. And this shows that the Solutrean people, the Khoisan from Africa, the first Paleoamericans, they brought these tools from Africa. That's how we know that they came from Africa, because they used the same tools.
Come on with it. There it is.
If the tools are dated to an earlier period in Africa than in Spain, than in the Americas, those tools had to have been first made in South Africa. You have been brainwashed.
I've got to put this up by Bantu. He says, back to the drawing board, Angela, peace. Now, let's do this.
Angela, please.
Angel. She says, this is going to be interesting here. Let me put the camera back on us. And now let's see, where is, okay, here we go. So there's two things that she says she's gone, but I don't know if she's still there or not. But she says, Dr. Winters is citing theories. I graduated gold in geography and geology. It is a fact North America has the oldest mountain range in the world. All right, so now you just told us that at one point, all of these continents were together. And so if the continents were together, then that's called simultaneity. So all, whatever the oldest is, it was because all of the continents were together. So of course it would be the oldest landmass, but when it separates, when those landmasses separated, you're thinking that it separated or that it was miraculously showed up on its own and is separate from the landmass that it was originally connected to. How am I doing here, Doc?
You're right. I mean, I love Angela, and I've seen her on other sites, and I think she means well, but if you got to go, I'm not trying to, I'm just saying the facts. Look, anybody after this talk, go look up Gondwana land, and you're going to see all the continents on the Gondwana land, and they separated. If they were already existing at the same time, there's nothing that you could do earlier. Mounds are formed by plates crashing into each other. One place mm-hmm. goes under the other, and when that plate goes under the other, it causes mountains to rise. That's okay, but you can't have an older geological, you know, place when they all existed at the same time.
At the same time, right. But over time, they separated. And yeah. So guess what? It's like a loss of memory. You're yeah. on a particular continent, and you think you're on the oldest continent. And you're looking at the other continents and saying, nah, that can't be. We're the yeah. oldest. No, you all were the oldest at one point, but you don't know because you woke up when the continents were separate.
That's right.
And now this is the argument, and it's not even a debate. It's a way, it's like Dr. John Henry Clark says, I don't care what you think. I just care that you think. That makes sense.
And not only that, but when people put that argument, and I know some indigenous nationalists, they try to put forth that argument that makes you look stupid. It makes you look stupid. I'm not calling anybody stupid, but it makes you look ignorant when anybody can look at the whole, look at Gondwana land and see all the continents pushed all together.
Right.
And then they separated. So how can one be older than the other?
Right.
But again, you have to think. And so then we know
the solutions. Let's put this back up here. Let's put your PowerPoint back up. Okay, here we go.
Okay, we know the solutions could not have came from Europe. They had to come from Africa. The ice was there. And, you know, these are the Paleoamericans, Naia and Luzia. And then we can see the first Europeans. Here are the first Europeans. This guy, the first guy in the middle.
Shutterman.
He's from England. And then here's your first Russian, Cro-Magnon man.
Wow.
See, this is Cro-Magnon man. See, when you read those books, they say Cro-Magnon man was the first European, and the Cro-Magnon man, he spread the Stone Age artifacts across Europe. This is who he was.
Wow, I love this. This is great.
He wasn't British.
I'm also going to send a shout out to Karen Luton. I love you, Goddess. I'm with you on that one. I feel you. I feel you, Goddess. Go ahead, Dr. Winters.
So here we can see that although up in the north there was a lot of ice, we can see that when those black people, the first the Australians, next the Solutrians, when they came from Africa, they went across into the Canary Current. Then they could take the Gulf Stream, and they could have went to North America. Or they could have taken the North Equatorial Current and sailed to Brazil. Remember, let me explain to you. See, people cannot even imagine how large Africa is. If you ever notice, I was talking to somebody the other day, and I was saying, I wish I could see a map of how Africa looks from outer space. Mm-hmm. They never show you any. They never show you any views of Africa from outer space. And I think it's because it's so massive. Mm-hmm, think about that. Mega Chad was over 100,000 miles wide.
Wow.
And it's only 2,000 miles from Africa to Brazil. But this map makes it look like it's a great distance.
Wow. Wow.
But Africa is just so massive. You know, if somebody, some of you who went to South Africa, you know how long it took you to fly. First, you had to fly into Europe. Then from Europe, you had to fly. And you may have stopped in North Africa to get refueled. Then you took hours and hours and hours to get to South Africa. Because that continent is massive. So again, it's a Lutheran culture. They originate in South Africa. They took it into took it into Iberia or Spain, and then across to the Americas. That's the only way you can explain it. You see?
Mm-hmm. So Ashe.
What does this tell you? It tells you that aberrational Africans have always been in America. Yes, you've always been here. The first Americans were black. The Mongoloid Indians are interlopers. This is our continent.
Yes, it is. Bahia,
Apuana, Zia, Kennewick Man. The Paleoamericans were black. Since the Paleoamericans were black, they're your ancestors. They're your ancestors. Every black person did not come over here doing slavery.
That's right.
It was black people already here. And then when some of us came over here doing slavery, they, in a sense, they just threw your mind among the rest of the colored people.
Mm-hmm.
That's why they called us colored people. That's how they were able to steal our land. They called us colored people because of the fact is that they didn't want to acknowledge who we were and where we came from. You see, you had to remember.
So, go ahead, Doc.
You had to remember. When people say that foundational Black Americans are unique people, they are so correct.
Mm.
They are so correct. And what makes it so correct is that I used to always, back in the day, I used to, you know, when I was teaching Afro-American history and I would teach my kids and we would talk about, you know, the free blacks.
Mm-hmm.
And then one of those kids, he was no good. One of the kids said, "Oh, Mr. Winters." I said, "Yeah. Where did those free black people come from?" I mean, he said that you said, they were talking about me, you said that they wasn't freeing black people from slavery. But how did these free black people keep showing up in the statistics and the census? I said they were just free. I didn't really research it. Now that I've researched it, they were black Indians who, after their white man took their land, called him a nigger. He didn't use the word nigger back then. He said colored people or free black people.
Mm-hmm.
See, that's why you see all these, this increase in all these free black people, you know.
Mm-hmm.
See, the white man, he was real slick back then. What he'd do is that he'd always say the last Indian died. And the last Indian wouldn't be dead, but they would say the last Indian died so they could take some more land. And then before you know it, they took all the land from black people. See?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so then those black people who are lucky enough to stay on the reservation as they claim, fine. But okay, come stop it. I'm so tired. I'm so tired.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
you see,
mm-hmm.
My wife, her background was Blackfeet and Cherokee and some Indian that they couldn't even speak English. I'm Choctaw. What the hell does that matter?
Mm-hmm.
To the white man, all he see is another nigga.
Mm-hmm. All he see, Ashe.
You better be B1.
You better be B1.
You better be B1. Because see, if you're not B1, you're opening yourself up to become third frequency.
Yes.
And eventually fourth frequency as you try to fight your ancestry. My ancestry and your ancestry is African.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
My heritage is Mississippi because that's where my daddy came from.
Right.
And my mama.
Right, right. I love this. Doc, let me, last question on this is that why should we know? It's a rhetorical question, but you got to ask because we want to hear what you have to say. Why should we know about first frequency Black Americans? Why is this topic, why is this subject radically necessary for us to get? Obviously, we've answered the question through the work, but, codify it for us.
We have to know that we have to know we are, because the fact is this is that we have to understand who we are and where we came from. And when foundational Black Americans understand who we are and where we came from, then you have a better opportunity of knowing it. You see, the white man, he tries to teach you a lot of stuff. Let me share the screen again.
Sure.
I'm going to try to hurry up and get through with this.
No, you, see, you don't have to.
The God.
You don't have to hurry up.
The God of the white man today. Okay, the God of the white man today is DNA. And so he always wants to teach you. No, he always wants to pretend that that this DNA shows that he was first. He was the first Egyptians. He was the first Cretan. He was the first every damn body.
Mm-hmm,
they tried to use Kennewick man for a long time to say that Kennewick man was white. And a lot of people used to, and in fact, when they first made a reconstruction of Kennewick man, he looked like the captain of the Star Trek, you know, Picard. but really, he was a Paleoamerican. But see, a lot of people don't know that the Paleoamericans, in a sense, had DNA, and some of this DNA we carry today. Right here, you can see a lady called Nieda Gwedan. You know, Gwedan, Dr. Gwedan, she's in Brazil. And she found in Brazil all these sites, 100,000 years old, that were made by Africans. She says they were made by Africans because we know they couldn't have came from Europe. And look at how far away Brazil is from West Africa.
Wow.
2,000 miles. See?
Wow. Wow.
We're not talking about hundreds of miles. We're talking about only 2,000 miles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Eurocentrists, they love to lie about everything. Whenever they look at an ancient skeleton, when they look at Nahia, you know, Apicua, also Luzia or Kennewick man, they always say, in a sense, that the phenotype is Melanesian. Here we see Melanesians, Africans, and Australians. They're all black people. But the white man, to confuse you nowadays, he tries to tell you that the only black people is in Africa. And do you know what? Some ignorant people do not believe that Melanesians and Australians are black, even though they look just like us.
Wow.
See, but this is how people can teach you a lie. And if they teach you a lie long enough, you believe it. You see?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But we also find that the Paleoamericans, I said earlier, were just like the first Europeans. Here we see the first Europeans. The first Europeans were Khoisan, and we know that in a sense, the first Americans were also Khoisan. We find that the Khoisan, or the earliest Americans, they believe they belong to what's called the M haplogroup. See, years ago, I sent a paper off. I was kind of, it was my first time really writing on our genetics. So I sent a paper off and I said, you know, the M haplogroup does not appear in America. And so I wanted to read, you know, whenever you have a peer-reviewed article, that means that other people who are experts in the field, they read your article and they tell the editor if they should publish it or not. And so then one of the people said, you're wrong, Dr. Winters. The M haplogroup does exist in the Americas. I said, no, it doesn't. But then they showed me, because see, the M haplogroup is haplogroups A, M7. Every haplogroup the Native Americans carry, the Mongoloid Indian, is from us, from black people. I found out that haplogroup M was common. You know, the oldest skeleton from China Lake in British Columbia, 5,000 years old, carried the M haplogroup. See? And so,
absolutely
see?
Absolutely amazing.
And see, but the European, he tell you that there's no genetic relationship. We find, in a sense, that Kennewick man, We don't know too much about his DNA, but Pinal woman, we don't know. Nahia, we do know, and Kennewick man. What they found is that the oldest skeleton in North America is of Anzac boy. The Anzac boy, he practices what's called he practiced what was he belonged to the R1 haplogroup. And it's very interesting, you know, because see, you know, a lot of articles, especially the Estes article, mm-hmm. they talk about the fact that Anzeek boy belonged to mtDNA M or D1. As I said before, when I say mtDNA, that means the matrilineal line. That's from the mm-hmm. mother's side. Mm-hmm. The Y chromosome of father's side was R1.
Mm-hmm.
R1. And mm-hmm. so I used to write a lot on this website called Egypt Search. And so when I pointed out the fact that R1 is found among Black people, they took all the articles off the internet that said that Anthropologist was R1. You know, wow. I mean, somebody said they must look at Egypt Search, but that was back when it was Afrocentric. And so this is very interesting. Because see, if the Anzeek boy in Europe carried R1, then we also find that the Ischium skeleton from Liberia and the skeleton of the Malta boy also carried R1, R1 haplogroup, and this is interesting because see. The white man tries to teach you that R1 is his haplogroup. That's a lie.
Wow.
You know,
wow.
Professor Gates at Harvard, his parents tried to tell him he was Indian, but he said he wasn't Indian. And when they did a DNA test, they found that he carried an R1 haplogroup. He said, yay, yay, I'm white. No, you're not white. Black people carry R1, you see?
Wow.
Let me explain to you what they do. I know a lot of you, anybody that's taken a DNA test, whenever you take the test, they compare your DNA to modern people. And they might say you got 10% Angolan, 15% from Morocco, maybe mm-hmm. 1% from Spain. That's the same thing they did with the Anzeek boy. Here we can see right here. These are some of the things that when they compared the Anzeek boy mtDNA, they found his mtDNA match M. It matched M1, M23, M3, M30, M9. But the white people said, aha, it also matched D. So they just said that the Anzeek boy, his mtDNA or matrilineal line was D1. But D1 just means M1. But here you can see. You could have said Anzeek boy was matched with anybody, but they specifically said D1 or D4 because they wanted to say D to make it look as though it was different from you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, some of you out there carry M1. Do you know what this means? Okay, so this is what another person who compared to Anzeek boy's stuff. You can see that the MT haplogroup was M7. M3, M2, M1. And the Y haplogroup was what? J2, R2, and H1, H1A. See? They just tell you whatever they want to tell
amazing.
You.
This is amazing. This is great.
They tell you whatever they want to tell you. See? And so then when we
this is great. This, hold is on. That, we take that off. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so what we find is that if Anzeek boy belonged to mtDNA M and D1, and the Y mm-hmm. chromosome, that's deep because let's look at Afro-Americans. Later, after they read my piece on Egypt Search, then they started saying that that Anzeek boy belonged to haplogroup crew, haplogroup Q. Now this is deep. You see, they said he belongs to Q, but look at this chart. As you can see on this chart, only two
wow.
percent of Native Americans carry Q. But look, foundational Black Americans, Afro-Americans carry 31%.
Wow.
31%. So
wow.
even if they say Anzeek boy belonged to Q, he was still you. Q.
My.
See? And then let's look at this. The reason that he wanted to get away from R1 is that here's a chart. And they found that foundational Black Americans, as you can see, they carry 23% R1B. Do you know what that means? That means those of you who are R1, you relate to Anzig Boy. That means that some of you out there who belong to the R1 haplogroup and the M1 mtDNA haplogroup, that means that you're still carrying genes that our great grandfathers carried. That shows continuity.
Yes, it does.
That shows continuity. Yes, and so why do you think the white man's scared of you?
Right.
I'm scared of you. Oh, I'm one of y'all. I'm scared of you too. Because you know what that means? This is your land. Foundation of Black Americans is your land.
Tell it to them.
See, you're still carrying the genes that your ancestors carried. We know at least 12 plus 2, 14,000 years ago.
Wow.
14,000 years ago.
Wow.
See, and then they did a DNA study of Kennewick Man. As I said before, they tried to make Kennewick Man look like Picard on Star Trek. And they found that Kennewick Man carried the X haplogroup. What about the X haplogroup? Oops. Who? What? You mean the X haplogroup also came from Africa? Yes. Yes. Yes.
Family, I tell you, this is this. I want to say this, Dr. Winters, if I may, before we talk about the special report that you produced for us. As I mentioned earlier in the beginning of this broadcast, fam, that this is going to be a little controversial for some of you. It's going to, you know, Dr. Winters brought up a very, very significant point in that it's our tribalism that is killing us. Is holding us back. Now, let's understand something. When we talk about trauma, when we talk about this concept that Dr. Joy DeGruy produced called vacant esteem, when you have been reduced to your lowest form, when you have been told you are nothing, have nothing, you no matter what you do, there is no such thing as Black excellence. When you have been successfully colonized, domesticated, suppressed, depressed, and oppressed, it takes a toll epigenetically on our brains. There's a neurobiology that we have a difficult time being told no, and we have a difficult time being wrong, because we have DNA in us that is not supposed to be there, but we have a DNA in us that because of this trauma, when we are made to be or feel wrong, either publicly or privately, but particularly publicly, we will fight tooth and nail almost to the point of literal stupidity just to be right. First frequency doesn't try to be right. First frequency tries to be free. Because when you're right, you're in what Dr. Edward Nichols refers to as dichotomous logic. Right, wrong doesn't exist. There's only one science. There's only one people. There's only one mind. There's only one God. Now, when you are suffering from, and you haven't self-diagnosed, but all of us, myself, everyone has certain levels where our self-esteem has been hijacked. Now, remember, you can have low self-esteem, but low self-esteem is still a sense of self. And so what happens is when you move into that vacant esteem, unbeknownst to you, because this is happening before your brain is fully developed, this is what's happening to you in childhood, you start to want to gravitate toward any group or anything that justifies you and makes you feel necessary, makes you feel needed, makes you feel wanted. See, this is the reverse psychology of what the Amu second frequency has done to us. they are the ones that really don't matter, which is why they're trying to write themselves into a history that they don't exist, because they have the lowest, they have the original vacant self-esteem, or a vacant esteem. They're the ones that they can't find any history where God said yes to them as first people. And as a result of that, they feel like, have you ever heard the term second-class citizen or stepchild? They feel genetically like a stepchild. They don't have a first history. They don't have a first story. So you understand why they did what they did and why they do what they do is because the further back they go, they become extinct. They don't exist. They don't have a story. They don't have the beginning of the beginning before the beginning began. They were not chosen by the Creator to be first to populate the entire planet and master the heavens and the earth. They weren't those people. But guess what? They want to feel like they matter. They want to feel like their existence has purpose. As a result of that, that's why they have done what they've done. But now that has infected us. And as a result of our tribalism, oh, I'm a Muslim, I'm a Nation of Islam, I'm a Hebrew Israelite, I'm a Moor, I'm a this, I'm a that. Nobody gives a shit when you have nothing to contribute to the planet other than your tribalism. You can't even trace your own tribalism back accurately. We're talking about B1, first frequency. We're talking about the first, prime. We're not primitive. Primitive is a derivative of prime. Prime means one. It means first. We are the first people. We had tribes. Let's say that back in the, we didn't, but let's say back in that time, we had all of those tribes, the Yakamores and the Muslims and this, but they were all one African people. And so if you get caught up because of your vacant esteem, you don't want to be wrong publicly. All of the stuff that you've been taught all of your life, I think it was Angel that was saying, I went to school and got this gold standard in geology. We got all of this stuff wrapped up in our ego, self-efficacy, self-image, and our self-esteem. It's hard sometimes when you wake up after 40, 50, 60, 70 years and realize that everything that you have been taught, or some of the things that you have been taught, has been a lie. It's hard to accept that. And I understand it and I get it. But here we're trying to heal our people and reveal to them for the first time. Many of you are going to experience and have experienced, but have not yet met your divine self yet, because you're so caught up. We're so caught up in this false identity of being a Negro or a nigga, third or fourth frequency. We know we're B1, but what does that really mean? How do you act? How do you move? How does that work in our cellular system? This is why, family, we don't debate, because you can't. You can't debate law. You can't debate the science of it. You can talk about it and might not like it or agree with it, but the reason why I seek out, again, the concept of shock, the reason I seek higher, omnipotent, conscious, cosmic knowledge is to find the experts to be able to restore our first frequency and to restore us and let us know and show us with maps and also with Dr. Clyde Winter's 40, 50 years of research, this is who you really are. I have been lied to. The moment that white boy on the boat came here in 1492, all bets were off, because we got told that this is who we are. And then some of us woke up and said, let me go out and find some more research and find some more data. But some of that data and some of the scholars that we have studied were quite aligned. They were third frequency. They were lied to. And so I'm trying to bring Dr. Winters on, because I can't find anybody like that Dr. Winters. I'm sure others exist, and other scholars have been on the platform like Dr. David Imhotep. But between David Imhotep and Dr. Winters, this is the closest you're going to get to the era of Van Sertima and Joe, Sheikh Anta Joe. These are the scholars of today that have even taken the scholarship of Van Sertima, Rashidi, and Jupp, and challenge that information and put new information because of new research on top of that. Dr. Winters, what I love about this cat is he is a researcher, and I never really got that. I never really understood, you know, research, yeah, I read a lot and study a lot and watch a lot of stuff, but a researcher, the fact that he is peer reviewed, that means something, because that means it's no argument. It went from a theory to a theorem. It becomes unequivocal. And I haven't had any other scholars on that have that level of scholarship that kind of shuts you up and shuts you down and shuts up the argument. Dr. Edwin Nichols is another brother. It's 55-year plus framework. He's undeniable. It's indisputable. And that's why we're bringing the elders and honoring our elders, because we have to wake up and stop this tribalism, get our self-esteem back without, I am a God, whether I am a Muslim, whether I'm a Yakima, whether I am a Hebrew Israelite, none of that matters. Professor James Smalls, Leonard Jeffries, and Wade Nobles was here in Sacramento some years ago, and we hosted them, and we had a Q&A session, and of course, some of the Hebrew Israelites came up and was trying to usurp Professor James Smalls' PowerPoint and his work, and James basically said, stop. I don't give a damn if you're more Hebrew Israelite. None of that matters. And this is Professor Small. He says, none of this stuff matters. What matters is that we're all Black people. We're all B1 people. And that was 6 years ago when he was here. So this is why Dr. Winters is on this platform. I do appreciate you guys reaching out and asking questions, but we're not debating. We don't do that. You can go on other platforms and do that and enjoy yourself. We're here to correct the correction that has been misappropriated and redirected to keep us confused. I am not confused. I know where to go to get the source of information. I know how to do deep primary research. And then the difference is I have the ability to talk to the actual people who are doing and have done the research, and then bring them to a live platform like this so that we can bring it to the family. That's all that we're trying to do here, fam, is to teach you why you are the best of the best. Leo Wright, I love you. Bayete, I think you're from South Africa. That's where I heard Bayete when I had King Bunganada III on. We are the same people. Yes, we are one people, the same people. And it's the tribalism that's killing us. That's how they got us. That's how we lost. That's how this happened, fam. Understand, let's not repeat history. We've got to let this thing go and look at, what does B1 mean? What does first frequency mean? What does foundational Black Africans or Americans, what does that mean? Versus, I don't believe in any of that. I'm a this and I'm a that. No, because to the AMU, second frequency, interestingly enough, second frequency sees you as B1, but they call you a nigga. They see you as a collective. They don't see you as a tribe. They see you as one people that, because of your existence, it's very hard for them to exist and matter. So if they can see you as B1, why can't we? Go ahead, Dr. Winters, talk to us about, if you have any comments about that, as well as the special report that people will bring.
Okay, well, I'm gonna be finishing up, but Kenneth McMahon, he goes back to, if you can show the slide, he goes back to the Colville tribe. Here's a picture of the Colville tribe, you see? But they tell you that Kenneth McMahon was a Mongolian, was a Mongoloid person. He wasn't. They always say that Kenneth McMahon, you know, he had African genes, but the thing is that what makes it so bad is they tell you this lie. You see, these are the California Indians. These are the people that he's supposed to be related to. And they say, in a sense, that the closest relative to Kenneth McMahon was Arikara. And here's a picture of the Arikara tribe. What I'm trying to end this, and what I'm trying to say is this. It's very important to remember, you see, that we, foundational Black Americans, we are the Paleoamericans. We never left here. We always been here. It's like what Reverend Matthews is telling you. There's nothing wrong with us. It's what they did to us.
Mm-hmm.
You see? Mm-hmm. It's what they did to us. I showed you using their evidence, their archaeology. I showed you who were the first people in America, the Paleo-Americans, the first foundational Black Americans. I showed you that even their DNA, they will tell you that the Paleo-American DNA has nothing to do with Mongoloid Indians, but it does have something to do with you. See?
That's right.
You. Do you get it? I'm just talking about us over here. Nigerians, they're proud of Nigeria. Nothing wrong with that.
Mm-hmm.
Caribbeans, they're proud of coming from Jamaica, Trinidad. Nothing wrong with that. But I'm a foundational Black American.
Facts.
My ancestry is African, but my heritage is Mississippi Choctaw.
Mm-hmm.
See?
Mm-hmm.
But I'm B1 because when they look at me, just like they looked at the other foundational Black Americans, they always saw you as the other.
That's right.
See?
Malcolm taught us this.
Yeah. And they took our land.
They don't give a damn what you are, Christian, right. Catholic. You're a nigga.
That's right.
That's what you are to them. You're colored. That's you're right. The other. Yes.
See?
Yes.
And they want to keep you. See? Mm-hmm. They got to keep you.
Mm-hmm.
They got to keep you. You see? They got
to. This is why
keep
we have to do this for ourselves. Somebody, somebody, let me put this, if I can find it. Where is it? Let me put it up in the chat here. Okay, I think this is it. Darlene X, this was very, very moving. She says, right now, I'm more interested in finding out about our history. The more I learn about our history, the more I come to love myself and my people. That's what we're doing. That's it. That's it. That's it, Darlene. That's what we're doing. That's why I do what I do, because I love myself so much, because I understand now that because God, the Creator, created me and you and us first, that means something. In this system of second frequency, ain't no love. Ain't no love for the matter of fact, quiet as kept, they don't love themselves.
They don't.
So how the hell can they love you? But they try to make you think that you ain't this and you ain't that. They try to say, well, Black Lives Matter. Well, we know brother Ron Spears, the physicist, says Black Matter lives. We are Black Matter. Black Matter is the only matter. Ain't no other matter. We are it. We are it.
Outer space is carbon. Carbon is black. All human beings are based on carbon. That means they're based on your blackness. See, but the point is this, is that when I was younger, people would say, here come that black guy. And they would say that because they would say that because I was teaching their history, but I showed you today. Mm-hmm. I brought you the receipts and then some.
Mm-hmm.
I brought you the receipts and then some.
Come on,
to show
dog. Yes,
you.
Did. Yes, you did.
The first foundational Black Americans were the Paleo Americans. And you and you and you are out there carrying those genes. Yeah, I didn't want to talk about being Choctaw back in the day. The Indians lose. But I didn't know at that time. We all lose when we don't accept our identity, because our identity is B1. 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 You gotta stand on it.
You gotta
stand on being black first. I don't care if you're in London. I don't care if you're in the Caribbean or whatever. You know, I'd like to I'd like to thank a lot of people who've joined me on Patreon and some people.
Wonderful.
I've had people join me on Patreon, even I think it's someone from the Caribbean and another one from London. So, oh, and they ask me questions and I answer the questions. So I invite all of you to join me on Patreon. And also Reverend Matthews has Patreon too. But the most important thing is this, as I told you, see, we're not here to jive you. We're not here to play no jive.
No.
We're not here to give anything that you can't prove.
That's right.
See, I don't spend time writing those PDFs.
Yeah, that's a lot of work.
I spend time writing those PDFs so that you can have the receipts. So you can have the receipts. And when you're talking to somebody and you're saying, well, Dr. Winner said this and Dr. Winner said that, and they say, where's Dr. Winner's receipts? If you got that PDF, if you got that PDF, you can show them the receipts.
I'm putting it in the chat now. There it is. There it is, family, for you.
We want you to know who you are. And not just to feel you're great.
Right.
Not just to know you're wonderful, but it's to know.
That's right.
It's to know. Right. I showed you how right in front of your face, they're using their DNA and they're using their archaeology to white you out of history.
Mm-hmm.
I know some of you young people don't know nothing about whiteout, but those of us that are old school, when we used to wipe up stuff, we used to get a bottle of whiteout so we could erase the character on the paper when we printed it, and that's what they've done with you.
That's right.
They tried to white you out.
That's right.
You see?
Now, there's a question in the audience I'm going to address, and I shouldn't, but I will. And the reason I'm going to address it is because it deals exactly with what I am dedicated to doing. Somebody asked, I'll put it up on the screen. Will this help our reparations case? You see, when you don't know who you are, you're asking someone who has successfully colonized, domesticated your mind, took from us, but it's not about reparations. It's about self-repair first. You can't, because if you, let's say that we get reparations, $100 million for everybody. All you're going to do is give it right back to the white man.
You want some Nikes?
So, you know, you keep talking about send me the checks, write the check and all of that BS. That's great. But you have to first know who you are to have a value. If you don't have any value, then yeah, you just want somebody to repair you. Now look at what you're doing. You're taking someone else and putting it outside of you, say someone else can repair me, needs to repair me. No. I repair myself. I don't need the check. I am the check. See, I'm off the grid. This is why I teach affiliate marketing and all of this. I use white people. I use European technology, but I don't make any money from the group. I make money with B1. There's 3 billion black people with a cell phone. Why the fuck would I spend my time and money and energy trying to get a check from something European that's foreign, that's trying to kill me and damage me? That's dumb. But I was a third frequency Negropean. I got it. And I wanted reparations and I wanted the white man to suffer and I wanted him to feel some kind of way. I don't give a shit about this group. I care about and love my people first. And my job was to prove to me first that we were first frequency people. Once I found that out, that was it. And we need to grow up. We need to think. We need to get this healing and this trauma out of us so that we stop being a victim and keep going back and asking the same people who've done us the most harm, trying to get some good out of them. That is just insane to me. Go ahead, Dr. Winters.
Okay, this does help with reparations. You may not know this, but there's many foundational Black Americans that have that have petitions in the American court.
Yeah.
And in the court of the Americas, most of the briefs, and a brief is a paper that you submit in a mm-hmm. court case. In these briefs, there's a frequent mention of my articles. Because see, many of my articles on genetics and archaeology, they're mentioned in these briefs because see, my research in terms of the Paleoamericans, the Black Native Americans, what it does is that I'll tell you, what happens is this: the white man rarely made treaties with us, and because the mm-hmm. white man rarely made treaties with us, then therefore, in a sense, you have to prove that you are indigenous. You have to be able to present documented evidence and cultural evidence to show that you're indigenous. Mm-hmm. What my articles mm-hmm. prove and why they're used in the Court of the Americas in these briefs is that it shows, one, a genetic base. Two, it shows an archaeological base. Mm-hmm. Also, another thing is that my research also shows that we still have our culture. The white mm-hmm. man taught mm-hmm. you. He taught you lost mm-hmm. your culture. Mm-hmm. He taught mm-hmm. you that he took everything away from you. He raped your mama He raped our African mothers.
Mm-hmm. And daughters. And
sons. For 300 years. But everyone. He raped those of us who have Choctaw, Ichi, yes. Seminole, Creek background. They raped our mothers right. for 400 years since
that's right,
1526.
Sir. That's right.
That trauma is there. That trauma is there. But see, we're fighting in the Americans' court to try to get reparations to prove that we were here. See?
That's right.
The white man did a paper genocide on us. And what mm-hmm. he did is that he took away our land and he called us colored people. He called us free blacks
mm-hmm.
while he took our land. He didn't let you call mm-hmm. yourself Cree, Seminole,
mm-hmm.
Cherokee. He let some people. I have nothing against the Mongoloid people.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
When they came here, we adopted them.
Mm-hmm.
But your FBA, Foundational right. Black American, you have no allies.
That's
you
right.
have no allies.
Dr. During Clark says we have no friends.
That's during right. the Pequot War.
Yeah.
During the Seminole War, our Mongoloid allies always sold us out.
Mm-hmm.
They
mm-hmm.
always sold us out. Don't you ever believe you can go to anybody for help because your first frequency.
That's right.
They're jealous of you.
You are the threat. We are the threat. That's why they hate us. They hate us because they hate us. We are the threat. Somebody mentioned something about Judge Brown or something. Whatever. Third frequency hate us. Hate yeah. themselves and hate us. They that's don't right. want to have nothing to do with us.
That's right.
They look like us, but they're not us. What's that old quote? My every skin folk ain't my kin folk or something to yeah. that effect, you know?
See, FBA is the most dangerous. That's mm-hmm. the most dangerous tribe on the planet Earth.
Mm-hmm.
Because
mm-hmm.
when you're FBA, you are the only people that exist in the history of the world.
That's correct.
That spread Pan-Africanism, B1, right. and that also yeah. fight worldwide white supremacy.
That's right.
See,
that's right.
These people that's know right. who I am. If you right now, mm-hmm. if you put in Clyde Winters on the internet, you'll see so much hate because they're afraid.
Right.
They're afraid that you're going to learn the truth.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's all I'm trying to do. Your first that's frequency. Right. Reverend right. Matthews is trying to bring you up and understand where you're going.
Yes. See? Yes.
Where you're going.
You don't know who you are. You have no idea how you're going to get there and where to go.
Thank you. You
are a wandering generality versus a thank meaningful you. Specific.
I went to university. I wanted to be a Negro European. My wife, may she rest in peace. I love that lady. My baby doll was great. And she said, nigga, I'll whip your ass. Nigga.
I believe she said that to you,
she
too.
She did. She told me, she said, yep. She said, she said, I don't worry about no woman ever taking you away from me, but you better not let them books brainwash your ass.
That's right.
Or you'll
that's
get right. a burning bed. A burning bed, baby. In other words, when you go to sleep, I'm going to say, love your people. Be one.
Yes.
Be one.
Yes. Yes.
Black thank first.
You, Thank you. That's it. That's it. Well, that's how you end a damn show. I mean, we're done. Hell, that's it. Again, Dr. Winters, thank you so much for this. And goodness gracious, each time I say the same thing every week. How did you top your top? How do you best your best? You keep doing it. You keep bringing the authenticity. But this collection is a collective that is creating new epigenetic tags, killing, collapsing old epigenetic tags to let us know this is why, and I forgot the sister's name, this is why you must love yourself unconditionally.
And some of the people, I know some of the people said, where can we get the PDFs without getting them? We do them every week because a lot of times I write them up that week.
There's a link you can go to. There's a link in the chat. A link in the chat, but there's also a link in the description where all of Dr. Winter's PDFs, all of his research that he's been on for these last, I think this is the 8th session that we've had. All of them are up on shockmetaphysics.com, but the links are in the, if you're on Facebook, I think the links are up top. And if you're on YouTube, the links are below. And so as a result, you should be able to get to everything that you need. Get the receipts. That's it. Because when you compile all of that data, all of those 8 PDFs together, that's like going into the UN and saying, here's the proof that I'm B1 first frequency foundational. There is no argument. Nobody can come in and try to knock it and block it. And if you want self-esteem, if you want to, you know, if you're caught up in the debate and wanting to win an argument, here is the research for you to win. Here is the research for you to win. If you just want to be right and free, here it is. Yeah, there it is. It's right in front of you.
And the thing about the Paleoamericans, I wrote a little bit about that in the book that I posted. But this is all the latest stuff, the latest genetic stuff, the latest anthropological research. Stuff. You need to know. As a foundational Black American, you've always been here. Always been here.
Yes, sir.
Your anthropology shows that. Your genetics show that. We're not new to this country.
Nope.
We've been here and we will be here.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Leo Wright, brother, absolutely love you. Mayor is the highest level and expression of unconditional love. And I marry you. I don't know how to roll my R's. I know you know how to roll your R's, but I unconditionally love you as well, brother Leo. Baete, and to the community, you know I love you. You know the work that we put in. You know the dedication. This ain't no hobby. This is a habit. This is something I've got to do. So I love you. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you for supporting us. Go get those PDFs. When you go to Patreon, type in Clyde Winters, join his Patreon. When you go to Patreon, type in Rev Shock, join this movement. It's more than a ministry. It's really a movement. So if you want to get the latest information on everything, how to protect yourself, your life and everything, I'm going to next month begin a series. I figured out how to do live streams on Patreon. So now we're going to be taking some information that we can't go and do on the regular show and the regular platform. And we're just going to bring you the heat. B1 First Frequency. We'll see you next week. Well, we'll see you tomorrow, actually, with the metaphysician and the physicist. That's right. Ron Spears is coming up. All right. What do you got, Dr. Winters? Close us out.
Can you close us out?
Ah, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you for asking. And thank you for reminding me. I just love you so much. That's why you're our elder. It's so wonderful. All right, family. So let's do this for a moment. Let's take in a deep breath. Inhale and exhale. Let's release all of the lies that we have been told. Let's, for the moment, release all the lies that we may have consciously or unconsciously believed. Let's be open to the truth and something that is indisputable. We are the first and only. We are the first love of the Creator. Let go of the day, let go of the week, let go of the year, let go of your previous life, and now it begins, where I simply say and you repeat, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is. Family, I love you. Brother Billy B-Man Bird, it's his Earth Day today. Love you, beloved. I'll see you Friday morning. Can't wait to be with you and love you up. Just wanted to give you a shout out on the show that your barcode came in today. We love you. We'll see you next time on First Frequency of Oneness.